we're going to talk about today is a different way of weed management. We're using cover crops or biology to do all the work that our standard tillage or mechanical cultivation was doing in the past. To make that easier, let's think about it in the terms of a garden. In a garden, we know that we can mulch out annual weeds. So if we put a layer of mulch on the soil, we can actually suppress those annual weeds, stop them from germinating and growing. Obviously, if we've told you to mulch a cornfield or a soybean field, whatever acreage you have, you would say that that's probably impossible and certainly not cost effective. Unless we can grow that mulch right in the field, that's where cover crops come in. So the cornfield behind me last year was a rye and vetch field. This spring, we rolled that rye and that vetch with a cover crop roller. It's a new tool that we designed here at the Rodale Institute to help us manage those cover crops without tillage, enabling us then to establish our cash crop into that mulch. So let's take a look at the tool first, because that's one of the pieces of equipment that's made this all possible. You can see that it's a cylinder or a drum. In this case, ours is 10 foot long because we plant on 4 30-inch rows. But you know, that's just engineering and mechanics. We can make this any size or shape that you want. We have some rollers that are being used in vegetable systems that are only 2 feet wide. And we have some on large farms that are as wide as 30 feet. And I think there's one now that's even 60 feet wide. So we know that that's just engineering or mechanics. What we're really interested in is the biology of the system and managing that biology in our favor to help us suppress weeds. So as this drum rolls across the ground and we have it on a 3-point hitch on the front of the tractor, what makes that nice is we can roll with the front of the tractor, and we have the planter on the back of the tractor so we can roll and plant at the same time. In that regard, it's one step operation. Rolling and planting, and then because we didn't till the soil, we don't have to come back and cultivate it. We're letting the biology or the mulch of that cover crop suppress the weeds and do all the work for us. You can see we have some blades on here. The blades don't actually cut the cover crop or the mulch. They just push it down in one direction, and then they actually crimp the stem. So we're crushing the stem, stopping the plant's ability to move nutrients up and down its stalk, and it'll die. We're working with annuals and winter annuals, so they're easy to kill if we wait till they bloom. Once they bloom and they're in full flower, easy to kill. We just roll them, crimp them, and then I'll show you the end result over here. What we've done now is we've ducked into the cornfield, and we're going to take a look at what's happening here on the soil. You can see the residue and the mulching effect that's left from the rye and the hairy vetch cover crop. We rolled it. It died naturally, so there's no herbicide and there was no tillage. This is truly organic no-till. And then you can see that we're left with this residue, this nice mat here, this thick mulch that's actually suppressing all the annual weeds and preventing them from growing, but allowing the corn plant to come up through there. So using modern no-till planter technology, we can get our corn seed or our soybean seed, pumpkin seed, cucumbers. We can do this with lots of different plants. Anything that has a large seed that we can plant with a planter, we can get right into the soil, cutting through this mulch. You can see how we cut it. Got the plant, the seed in the ground. Plant comes up through it, the weeds don't. It's a really nice system and allows us to take advantage of the biology that we know can work, and also the technology that and the mechanics that we can do with modern no-till planter technology and the cover crop roller crimper.
Is everybody going to be able to hear me way back there in the back? Well, what you are standing in the middle of right now is what we call the Farming Systems Research Unit here at CEFS. This is an experiment that's meant to be long term. We always like to say at least 100 years or past my retirement. So we have 14 different cropping systems who are being tested against each other for their long-term sustainability. Right here at this nexus is we have 4 different organic treatments that are being compared, but we're here to talk about no-till. We've been fine-tuning and working on it. I want to give everybody a status update on where we're at, and then I also want to show you we have redesigned this planter. Every year we redesign it, and where we're at with the design of it and how our reliability is with that planter. So as I give you a little background, then I want to get everybody to come up alongside here and so we can look at the different components and talk about how we're working with it. So the background on the no-till organic system is really getting started with soybeans. And we got started with soybeans because what organic farmers do with soybeans right now doesn't work about half the time. So if y'all are anybody who's new into the organic corn and soybean production, our systems are based on very frequent cultivation. So that really is the Achilles heel of organic production, is a tremendous number of passes across the field. So how about going no-till, or how about reducing tillage? Can we go no-till like conventional farmers? I don't think anybody really thinks that. We have no answer for the perennial weeds if we're gonna go long-term no-till. We have to have tillage in the system, at least with our current technology, to be able to disrupt the weed cycles. But we can shift when that tillage occurs. Here to talk about corn varieties for organic producers, we've got Dr. Ron Heiniger, the corn specialist for NC State. So thank you, Dr. Heiniger, for being here.
Well, thank you, Chris, for having me here. It is a pleasure to talk to you, particularly about corn this year, because corn has been sort of our shining crop. We like rain when we have corn, and of course this year we've had it in abundance here. So first of all, let me state the obvious. One of the most important decisions you make when you're engaged in organic corn, or conventional for that matter, is the variety or cultivar that you're going to select. Because what you are going to do with that cultivar is try to match the potential that genetics has to the environment in which it's being grown in. Chris is trying to mimic the environment that most of you are going to grow your corn in, which is very important.
Corn and soybean, a typical corn planting target date for us is the last week of May, and soybeans about a week later than that. Everything goes in at the same time and it's managed uniformly going this way as far as the cash crops go. Drill the cover crops with this drill here that's got the two seats on there and the cone mechanism, so we're able to mix our seed up pretty precisely. We can actually, you know, weigh it out to the gram in these little packets. We got to make about 1,600 of them. Up, and then two people sit on the back there and dump a little baggie like this into those cones, and that's how we do this. So the cover crop establishment and this kind of a project can be a little bit of a challenge in terms of the different seeding depths for the different size seeds. We put them all into the same depth. We have no control over putting, you know, big seeds deep or anything. We designed some mixes with 3, 4, or 6 species of cover crop.
So here we are back again out at the Penn State Research Farm. I'm going to go ahead and explain some of the implements that we use out here for our research in either the organic rotational no-till or in the more traditional full-till organic studies. So this here is the roller crimper, and the purpose of this implement is to roll down cover crops prior to planting. And this implement is pretty critical to the organic rotational no-till in that you grow your cover crop up, and if you don't want to till it under in order to kill it, then you need to roll it down and crimp all of the stems. And so the way that this thing works, it weighs in at about 3,300 pounds. This large barrel has a series of blades around it. You roll it across your cover crops. These blades, which are kind of shaped in a V shape, we call it the chevron style. They roll down and crimp all of the stems. It's important that you don't actually cut the stems or else you'll get regrowth. And after they're laid down, if you get that timing right during flowering of the cover crop, then you get decent kill. Here at the research station, we prefer to run our roller front mounted as opposed to running it on the backside. If you run it on the front, you can get a good look at what's rolling down and how well it's rolling down. And also you've got a bar running up front that helps to knock down the cover crops initially, kind of gather it in so that everything gets under there and ends up under the roller and therefore getting rolled down and crimped and hopefully killed. So in the arena of more traditional cultivation techniques in organic, this is a tine weeder. So we wouldn't be using it in the rotational no-till, but in maybe a full-till system. And so the way a tine weeder works, it has a series of these spring-loaded tines that drag across the ground. And if you gotta drag it fast enough so that they just kinda run over the ground, they vibrate a little bit, they pull out newly emerged weed seedlings. So this is a traditional cultivator that we use in the full till system. And the way that this works is to have a series of shovels that run in between the crop rows. So if you can imagine, here is where your crop row would be. To either side of that, we have a gang of five shovels, runs between them, digging up dirt and weeds, pulls out small to medium in size weeds, and also throws dirt up against the crop row to help with in-row weed suppression.
So we're back at the agronomy farm today to look at some of these different cover crop treatments that we were discussing at the field day the other day. Behind me here is corn that was planted this May and will be harvested for silage next week. This corn last year, after wheat harvest, was planted to a cereal rye monoculture cover crop. And we want to contrast this corn, what you see here, to some other cover crop treatments down the row. One thing to notice here is the relative height of the corn. It's about as tall as the top of my hand. And in general, this corn is relatively nitrogen limited, as we'll see in contrast to some other plots down the row. All right, so here we're looking at cover crops that were just planted a few weeks ago following wheat harvest. In this plot right behind us here, we have a monoculture of Austrian winter pea. And you'll see this is a vining legume that comes up and will form a dense mat of vegetation this fall and will overwinter and produce nitrogen-rich biomass next spring and then can be incorporated before next year's corn crop. This is the same treatment, just at a different point in the rotation. So this was last year's Austrian winter pea cover cropped plot that was then planted to corn this spring. This is a four species mixture. It has red clover, Austrian winter pea, rye, and also canola. And these four species are mixed together to try to get the more functions, more benefits from each of these different species if we grow them together is the goal.
Addition of your cocktail mix, right? Your rye and veg, the radish will be down there and bring up some nutrients that you can't.
Well, and so here we have a little demo set up where you can just get a sense of what that looks like laying on the ground. And so this is rye that we harvested. It wasn't harvested at the same time that you'd normally kill this stuff, but just for an example. And so, like down at the low end, we've got 2,000 pounds to the acre. You can see plenty of grass coming up through that. If you can imagine that, what that looks like from a weeds perspective, there's plenty of sunlight coming through. And then this ranges all the way up 4, 6, 8, 10,000 pounds. We don't get anything like 10,000 pounds here. We're generally in the 5 to 6 range, and we find that sufficient. If you were to get a good close look at this, there's still a little bit of light coming through, but bear in mind that the crops are gonna be living and not totally senesced and dried like this here, so you do get adequate weed control in that situation.
Now. So for example, we saw this morning where they had just prepared the seedbed for the triticale and hairy vetch and the reduced tillage experiment. So this came out of that plot that we're standing right next to. So there, this is, it had manure applied to it. The soil's been tilled a few times to prepare the seedbed. There's been very little, if any, cover crop growth on it.
That's a 67.
Woody?
The first.
What's that? Yeah, just down to the first.
hold it in for 2 seconds.
Grasses generally have a low nitrogen content in their biomass. They have a high seed-to-end ratio, and when you plow them into the ground, what happens is they actually tie up nitrogen as they decompose. Clover was, it was 25 parts per million. Now for this four species mix with canola, pea, but this meter here is called the spad meter. And actually what it does is this little thing clips onto a leaf. And if you can kind of see from an angle, there's a little window there, and it actually shines a light through the leaf, and it measures how much of that light is absorbed by the chlorophyll molecule. And the readout here, we marked it out 17 feet 5 inches. We counted the number of ears in a thousandth of an acre. Then we took every fifth ear and we counted the number of kernels around and the one length of harvestable kernels, and we got calculate how many tens of thousands of kernels do we have in an acre, and then you divide by 90,000 per bushel. And then you can do another conversion to get into ton equivalency for silage. So we did that for the rose experiment.
These three treatments out of the cocktail project. In the spring when we mowed it down, before we planted it in, there was 2,000 pounds per acre of clover biomass.
What are some observations?
No tail.